This is an art attack.
This is an art attack. This is art attack. Welcome to Art Attack. Now, have you ever noticed the way sometimes the most enjoyable things to do can often be the messiest? Well, come and have a look at this. This is something I really enjoy doing. Dropping splodges of wet paint onto wet paper. Look at that. The way the colours all merge together and create a pattern running into each other. Now, if you leave that to dry and then do it again on the other side, you get this sort of effect. And this can be used to make some great butterflies. I'll show you how to do it. You need another sheet of paper. You need to fold that sheet of paper in half. And then down the folded edge, you need to draw half a butterfly. Not a whole butterfly, just half one. And then you simply cut that out, throw the butterfly bit away. We don't actually need that, because this is the bit I want. I want the butterfly stencil. Now, if you actually have trouble drawing a butterfly, let me give you a quick tip. All you need to do is draw an elongated figure eight and turn it on its side, draw another elongated figure eight across it, draw a body down the middle, and there you have it, a butterfly. Looks a bit more like a moth, really, doesn't it? But when you cut it out, that'll do as a butterfly stencil. Then it's a case of taking your stencil and using it to scan over your splodge picture, looking for a good butterfly pattern. Now, there's a really good one because it's got a similar pattern on either wing. And just get a pencil, draw through your stencil like that. I'm not going to do all of it because we'll be here all day. And then you cut it out and it gives you one coloured butterfly on both sides. And you just get some cotton, you lay it on the head of the butterfly. I think that's the head end. Put some sellotape across it. Pick it up, and there it is. One rather good butterfly. Now, I've found it's a good idea to stick some of that see-through sticky-back plastic on both sides of your butterfly, and then hang it up in your bedroom. Rather good. You know, I like the way they shine.
Wet paint on wet paper. Do it on both sides and stick where you want. But not on the end of my nose. Oh, you'll get it off. Well, thanks a bunch!
Next time you're on the beach, why not try a sand attack? This man does.
Here we are on Weymouth Beach. The best beach in the country. All over the world, as far as I'm concerned, because it contains Weymouth sand. And Weymouth sand is something that I've been able to play with and model with for years and years, ever since the early 20s. I'm Fred Darrington. Fred to everybody. Two-year-olds to 72-year-olds. I build the sand models on the sand, sometimes called sand modelling, sometimes sand sculpture. All I need to do is get a handful of sand, wet it with seawater, mould it into shape. Use a knife, carve it, brush it off, that's it, that's sand. I don't need anything in it. There's no cement, there's no fixative, there's nothing else but sand and seawater. say, no, that's not sand. They watch me working on it and say, well, it can't be sand. But it is. All I gotta do is put my finger in it and say, well, there you are, it's sand. I've made over the years everything from a mouse to an elephant in the animal world, and I mean that. Fruit, vegetables, cakes, bananas, fried egg, sausage, bacon. It's possible to do it with Weymouth sand.
Whole lineup of famous cartoon characters there, and here's a lineup of one cartoon character who hopefully one day will be just as famous. Remember him? Bones the Cat, the cartoon character that we've been creating over the last few weeks. Now I'm just trying to decide on a colour scheme for him, and I think it's important that his colour matches his personality. And you know, I think he's got to be very bright. But I also like the stripy effect. I think it gives him a sort of comical feel. Now, I think he's slightly posh as well. So how's about this very plush, velvety purple for his jacket? Do you know, I'm quite pleased with that colour scheme. I think it's pretty good. So, OK, you've got your cartoon character, you've named him, but what does he actually do? Well, he could be a cricket umpire. He could be an astronaut. He could be a famous fighter pilot. He could even be a school teacher. Now, the truth is, he can be whatever you want him to be if you've invented the character. And do you know what I want Bones to be? I want him to be a private detective. In fact, let me introduce you to Sherlock Bones, the private detective. I think it suits him, don't you? He's sort of very proud and full of himself. I think, though, he is slightly scatty, a sort of bumbling detective. And you know what he needs? He needs an assistant. And I've done him as well. Let me introduce you to Sherlock Bones' assistant, the trusty old man himself, What's Up. And there they are, Sherlock Bones and What's Up. Did you get it? Sherlock Bones and What's Up? Well, they go on their first adventure next week. Watch out for that.
My name's Abby and this is my silhouette.
My name's Shane and this is my silhouette. And at the time my mouth was open when they were drawing it.
My name's Gav and this is my silhouette and Edward drawed it for me.
Hello, my name's Billy and this is my silhouette and we put white on top of black.
Clever art attack, and very easy to do. All you need is a larger sheet of paper pinned to the wall in a dark room, your own head, that's me, and a lamp or torch to shine onto your head to cast the shadow onto the wall. Then you need someone to draw around the silhouette. Ta-da! But you've got to keep the torch still. And your head. Then you turn the lights on, you cut the silhouette out. What do you think? Looks more like him than me. Here's something to think about. Can sound make pictures? Well, you've heard of paint by numbers. Why not paint by music? I wonder what it would look like.
Thank you.
It's great fun. Stick on your favourite music and have a go. But obviously do it outside, and obviously do it on some paper. Otherwise you'll end up with a huge, great, enormous, ugly mess. Now that's what I call timing.
Do you know, a lot of famous artists have difficulty drawing hands. Well, I've found a good way of doing them. Simply divide them up into sections. Now what have we got here? Well, the palm of my hand I've drawn like a plate, and hanging off each side of the plate there is three sausages for each finger, and for the thumb I've got two sausages there. There it is. Now it's just simply a case of watching what each of those sausages does. And look at this. Put my hands into that position. What have we got there? Well, we've got the plate down there, and we've got one, two, three sausages there. And we've got one, two, three there. And the thumb, we've got one, two, pointing up like that. Now, if you do this in pencil, you can go over it afterwards with a pen. And then it's just a case of, you've done it, rubbing the pencil out. And there you have it, a hand. Handy thing, sausages. You know, you really don't have to be a brilliant artist to give yourself an art attack. Look at this, a blotting paper star, and on top of that, I'm going to glue another blotting paper star, and on top of that, another blotting paper star. I've drawn a design on it there in felt-tip pen, and it's a case of folding in the petal, folding in another petal there, another petal there, and you just keep going until you've folded in all the petals. See you next week.